to be here. Welcome to church. Glad you've come to Harvest today to worship Jesus, and we're going to get in God's Word. You can open up your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to be there today, and I'm Pastor Greg, the campus pastor here, and be blessed to be sharing the Word of God with you this morning. Faith is a central theme of the Word of God, and throughout the pages of Scripture, we read stories about men and women of faith that inspire us in our own faith journey. And one of the most concentrated areas in Scripture that talks about these faith stories is found in Hebrews chapter 11. It's affectionately called the Hall of Faith. Many of scholars call it the Hall of Faith. And the writer of Hebrews is exhorting and encouraging the early converts to Christianity because they're facing significant persecution. It's very hard for them, and many of the early converts are questioning whether they can continue in the face of the persecution, and many of the brothers and sisters are turning back to Judaism. And so the writer writes this letter to them to encourage them and exhort them to remain true to the Scriptures and to their call to follow Jesus. And the writer tells stories here in Hebrews chapter 11 of the heroes that we know of. Many of them you know: Abraham, Noah, Moses. But the writer in verse 32 says, "And what more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, and David, and Samuel, and the prophets." And then he actually goes through and lists many unnamed faithful people throughout the ages. And so the writer's saying, I could just tell so many more stories. And many of us are familiar with Noah and Moses and David. But there are so many more everyday people like you and me that demonstrated uncommon faith that aren't as heralded as the Noahs, the Abrahams, and Moseses. And so the title of our summer series, what we're going to be going to through together as a church family, is called Unsung. Everyday people, uncommon faith. And we are going to examine men and women in the Bible that maybe don't get as much attention, but that demonstrated uncommon faith so it will inspire us towards persevering faith. And you're going to have multiple pastors coming in to share God's word, going through different characters of the Bible to encourage you and strengthen you and spur you on in your own faith journey. Today's title, the message, the introductory message today, is called The Impact of Persevering Faith. We're not going to go through a character today. We're going to set the stage, the foundation. And so the title is The Impact of Persevering Faith. We're going to start in Hebrews chapter 11 and go through verses 1 through 3. Would you look at it with me? Let me read it. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the convictions of things not seen. For by it, the people of old received their commendation. By faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. The title of the message, The Impact of Persevering Faith, our first point is this: persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. Persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. Verse 1, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the convictions of things not seen. Faith is a major doctrine in the Scriptures, and there are many facets of faith. We're going to look at a couple of them today, but it's not the whole picture. Many people think that this passage is the definition of faith. It's really not the definition of faith. It's maybe a description and kind of helping us understand faith. But let me just go through kind of a summary of faith, and that'll help us understand what we're going to talk about, what we're going to study today. So look at this chart. I call this chart Faith Fundamentals. So first, most importantly, faith has an object. And who is that object? Come on, family, who's the object? Jesus. Faith has an object, Jesus. Hebrews 12, it says that Jesus is the author and perfecter of our faith. If we're going to have faith, one of the facets of faith is it has an object, and that object is Jesus. Number two, faith has an outcome. Faith has an outcome. If you have faith in Jesus Christ, your outcome is salvation. Your outcome, 1 Peter 1:8 says, you will receive the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. So faith just doesn't have an object, it has an outcome. Number three, faith has an output. Faith has an output. That output is works. All right? In James chapter 2, it says, faith without works is dead. So faith has an object. Faith has an outcome. Faith has an output. Thirdly, faith has an outreach. The lost. Romans chapter 10, how beautiful are the feet that brings good news, it says. And then it says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the word of God. And so if you have faith, part of your faith, a facet of your faith, is an outreach to the lost, all right? And they hear the word of God through a brother or sister or a future brother and sister, and they come to faith. And then lastly, where we're going to be today, faith has an outlook. That's assurance and conviction. This is an outlook. This is the perspective on faith that we're going to be talking about. So remember, this isn't the complete definition of faith. It's a key component of faith that we're going to talk about, but it's the outlook. All right, so again, look at verse 1. There's two phrases in here. Now, faith is, first phrase is the assurance of things hoped for. All right, what does the word assurance mean? In the Greek, it's an objective guarantee. It means certainty. It means reality. It means like a title deed. Like you've received something that you know you are getting and it's yours, but you don't have it yet. It's a possession. It also means substance. It means to accept the reality of, you could see it there, the assurance of things hoped for. Kind of think of it like this. It's not like a wishing well. It's not like you're sitting in front of your birthday cake wishing for something you could get. No, it's something that you believe and there's a reality to it. It's really coming. It's not a wish like this. It's a hope in something that God has promised to you that is substantial and it is real. That's what it means here when it says the assurance of things hoped for. Here's a picture of a family in our church. That's the Wooden family. We love the Wooden family. And so we got John and Maggie and Rex and Uriah, and we were able to, last summer, put together a golf outing for them to raise some money for them to get a service dog that's going to hopefully really encourage and bless the kids, help them get around, help them have a really good friend. The dog is going to be unbelievable. It was super, super expensive. But we were able to raise a bunch of money. Many of you participated and gave money to that. We were able to help the family, and they have now had enough money to get a contract on the dog, all right? When they got the money, the dog didn't even exist. It hadn't even been born yet. But they had a contract that when the puppy was going to be born, it was going to be trained, and they're in the process right now of waiting. It's going to be like August of 2020, maybe, where you actually get to see the dog and then start. But that dog, even though it wasn't born, now it's born, they believe. They don't know yet, but they think it's born now. It's starting to get, but that dog is whose? Whose dog is it? They paid for the dog. The dog is coming, and they know. It's a guarantee. That's what their hope is set on. That's what this is talking about here. It's not wishful thinking. It's a reality that God has said some things to us. We are assured of it. Look at verse 13, talking about some of these heroes of the faith. They all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them, greeted them. This is what happened with them. They were promised a land. Abraham was promised a land, wasn't he? God said, I'm going to give you this land. Did he see it? No. But he acted like he already had it. He greeted it, it says. He knew it was his, and it was his. He just didn't get to live to see it, but it went to his ancestors. It's that kind of assurance in living in light of what is real, the assurance of things hoped for. God has made you some future promises. It's actually amazing. He's made some future promises. He's also done some things currently. He's done some things in the past. His acts from the past and his acts for the future are done. Oh, wow, a clap. All right. But let me just say, with God, what he has done and what he says he will do is already done. Time is not a thing with God. His word is timeless. And when he does it or says he's going to do it, it is, say it, it's done. And so this is the assurance that the writer of Hebrews is trying to encourage those people that are struggling, saying, if God has said it, it is. And you just have to wait on it because it is coming. That is faith. That is faith. I defined it like this phrase, anticipation of the reality and blessing in the unseen future. Let me say that again. Anticipation of the reality and blessing in the unseen future. Jeremiah 1:12, God says, I'm watching over my word to perform it. He knows what he said. Do you know what he said? And are you acting with the assurance that what he said can be hoped for? He says in 1 Thessalonians, the Bible says that he is faithful. And then it says he will surely do it. And I want to encourage you and inspire you to have that kind of faith on the promises of God because it changes your life. Here's the second phrase. You see it there. Assurance of things hoped for. Here's the second one. The conviction of things not seen. Phrase two. The conviction of things not seen. The word conviction is basically like proof or evidence. Faith is believing in the unseen. And we have lots of things, guys, that we believe in that we don't see. We believe in the wind. We believe in electricity. You believe in love. You believe in heat. But you don't see those things, but you believe in them. And as Christians, we changed our lives by believing in some things that we hadn't seen. Your life has changed because you've chosen to believe in some things that you haven't seen. Namely Jesus, namely the resurrection, his Holy Spirit, his sovereignty, his grace, angels, that he hears our prayers. This week I went to the Hillsong concert. Anybody go to the Hillsong United concert? It was unbelievable. This was Monday night at the Sears Center. And amazing worship. Hillsong United, one of the leaders in Christian worship, and it was over the top amazing. There was a bunch of us, there were 41 of us in our group, and there were 19 in my kids' group. So there was like 60 of us that all went together. It was super fun. My son Christopher was there, and he was worshiping his face off with his friends, and he's actually interning up at Harvest Bible Chapel Spring Lake this summer, so he left Monday night. Tuesday morning he leaves, and goes back up there, and Hillsong actually was at Grand Rapids, and he went to the concert at Grand Rapids on Tuesday, two nights in a row. You got to know that last summer, I got a call from Christopher. He was in the hospital because he had a collapsed lung. Tall, skinny guys like him, you know, string beans, they're susceptible to collapsed lungs, and he had a collapsed lung. He texted us on Tuesday morning and said, Mom, Dad, I feel the same pain that I had when I had the collapsed lung. I'm going to urgent care right now. And immediately, I texted my guys. I think I've told you before, I got like 30 guys on a text string that are blessing me and praying for me right now in the middle of all the things that were going on in the church. And I immediately texted the guys. Why did I text the guys? Why did I text the guys? I wanted them to pray. But why deeper? Why did I do it? Because I believe in something that I've never seen. I believe that the God of the universe, when the guys pray, turns his face and listens and chooses to answer. And he can answer however he wants. But one thing I believe that I've never seen is that God listens to prayer. And so I acted on it. So, Christopher, we're waiting to hear all the prayer going on. He texts us back. Mom, Dad, I just got to let you know what happened. I have a strained muscle in my side because I was worshiping so hard last night, I pulled the muscle. So I'm just telling you, it could have been different. It could have been different. It could have been us getting in the car and going back up to the hospital again and sitting there worried about his future because of the collapsed lung, but no. It was a strained muscle because my son worshiped two nights in a row and overdid it, which is fine. That's answered prayer. But the point I'm making is I believe in something I've never seen. I believe in God's sovereignty. I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe in Jesus. I believe in the resurrection. Some people saw it. I didn't. Jesus said, blessed are those who believe and have not seen. That's this, the conviction. The evidence of things not seen, that's what the writer's talking about here. Here's how I summarize this. This conviction is the acceptance of the reality and blessing in the unseen past and present. Hope is conviction and reality in the blessing of things in the future. This conviction now he's talking about is your understanding and acceptance of the reality and blessing of things from the past and the present. See the difference in the two? You have hope for the future because he's made some promises, but you also believe in things you have never seen because it's a reality also. All right? Oswald Chambers says this. This is really cool. Makes it pretty simple. Oswald Sanders, missionary, says this about faith. It enables the believing soul to treat the future as present and the visible as seen. All right, if you get that, I'm bringing the message today and whatever, but Oswald Sanders basically summarizes this first point right there. What the writer is saying is exactly that. The ability to treat the future as the present. It's mine, and the unseen is, it's real. It is real. I've never seen it, but it is as real as I'm preaching to you right now. All right? How do we apply this verse to our lives this morning, verse 1? Well, I think it'll help if we really examine the things that undermine our faith. Things that undermine our faith. And I really feel there's two things that undermine your faith and undermine my faith. It's fear and doubt. All right, so now we're getting to application of point 1. Undermining our fear is fear and doubt. If you want to grow in faith this week, if you want to apply what I'm saying to you, what the Lord is saying to you in this verse, if you want to apply, here's what you can do. Identify your fears and go to the Word and attack your fears with His truth. Do a little examining. Scan the horizon of your life and identify your fears, and then go to the Word of God and let the Word of God attack your fears with His truth. Believe me, your fears will be abated. Your fears will be overcome by the reality of what God says about it. We are fearful not because the source of the fear is so amazing or so powerful. We are fearful because we don't go to the ultimate power source, which is Jesus Christ, who has victory over that. All right? So if you want to apply it, take some time this week, and what am I afraid of? What am I fearful of? Am I fear of my finances? The struggle, then I go to Philippians chapter 4. I will supply every need of yours according to the riches that are in Christ Jesus. Bam! Your financial thing is nothing to God. Nothing to God. You got some relational issues? Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and read about love and what love really is, and that love never fails. That relationship has no chance against love. None. I don't know when, I don't know how, but it has no chance. So don't be fearful of the relationship problem right now. Get in God's word and get encouraged by it, and then live it out and watch him do something. That's faith. Assurance of things hoped for. The convictions of things not seen. How about doubt? What are your doubts? Same thing. What am I doubting? Usually when we doubt, we don't, as a Christian, we're not really doubting things in the world. We're doubting the character of God. I doubt that he's good. I doubt that he loves. I doubt that he's powerful enough. I'm doubting that he's aware. I'm doubting that he's really faithful. Man, get your doubts, list them out, go to the word of God, and slay them. Slay those doubts with the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Slay those doubts with the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, the Bible says. And those doubts, will be like nothing to God. And as you rightly perceive reality, the doubts fade. And then when they creep back, what do? You go right back to the truth. All right, so that's application for point one. Persevering faith anticipates God's blessing and strengthen your persevering faith with assurance and conviction. Here's the second point. Persevering faith receives God's approval. Verse 2. Persevering faith receives God's approval. Verse 2 says, for by it, faith, the people of old received their commendation. The writer now is setting up verses 4 through 40. Verses 4 through 40 of Hebrews chapter 11 start to identify all the heroes of the faith. And they received commendation for their faith. And so he's starting to set it up. All right? And so what does that mean for us? Well, let's first look at what the word commendation means. Commendation, it means that God keeps track. He makes notes. He gives a testament. He's a testimony to what has happened. It's a record. It means he doesn't forget faith. He doesn't forget your acts of faith. Look at verse 6. Look down the page. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. Whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists, and that he rewards those who seek him by faith. So the commendation is not in the acts, actually. The commendation is in the heart. It's in the faith that spurs the action. Nothing, this is important, we have it on the screen. Nothing outside of faith can please God. No good deed, no good word, no good thought is worth anything to God unless its seed, its origin, or its source is faith. You can do a lot of good things. You can think a lot of good thoughts. You can say a lot of good words. But if its origin is in faith, it doesn't please God, because what does it say in verse 6? It is impossible to please God without, say the word. Correct. Correct. Here's the thing. God doesn't get fooled. God doesn't get faked out. He knows the heart. God looks on the inside. He doesn't look at the outside at all. He looks at the inside. And he wants everything to be its seed and origin to be faith. But he's not fooled, he's not faked, but also he doesn't forget. He watches, and look what it says in verse 6. And that he rewards those who seek him. Verse 2, your faith is commendable to God. Verse 6, your faith is rewarded by God. He's watching every single act, every single thought you have in the truth of who Jesus is an act of faith that is commendable to him. Just your thoughts, the right thinking about God is commendable to him. That's what it says here, right? Verse 1 talks about the assurance and convictions. Verse 2 says, by it, faith, assurance and conviction, they were commended. It's not the things they did, guys. It wasn't that Moses was faithful or Noah built the ark. Yes, that was an outflow of his faith, but it was his faith that made him do it, and that's what he was commended for. His belief. Yes, acts of faith are important, and we'll see it all throughout this chapter. But don't forget, the source is always faith, and without it, nothing can please him. Nothing. I really think it's important to hear from these verses the combination of what you believe being important to God and what you do. So often in the church, we go right to what do we do? And we judge each other by what they do. And we know that faith without works is dead. We know that someone who really does have faith, there's going to be fruit. But I'm telling you, in these verses, know that your thoughts about God, your meditations about God, your worship in your mind when you think about him, it's so important to God. It's commended as faith, what you think, what you believe about him. And then also, look at all the stuff in chapter 11. What you do with it is also a reward. But we're commended and rewarded by both what we think about him and what we do for him. It's both. Look at this chart. So this is the practical application of point two. All right, I always try to get as much as I can for you when I'm preaching. What can you do this week that's going to help you take some ground? And I think this is one for point two, all right? So faith from belief to behavior, all right? We just talked about it. God cares about both what you think and what you do, all right? I'm suggesting that maybe this week you write down some things you believe about God. I just gave three as an example. Number one, I believe that God's the creator. I believe that he spoke the world into existence. We're going to talk about that in the next verse. I believe that. So, what is the thing I'm going to do about it? I will never doubt his power to change my circumstance. Because if he has the power to say, supernova, poosh, power to do Pacific Ocean, poosh, if he has that kind of power, does he not have power to help change my circumstance if he so chooses? For sure. So you go from I believe to I will, all in faith. I believe this about God by faith, and I'm going to do this for God or for someone else by faith. This is practical application number two. God loves me unconditionally. No matter how I act towards him, he loves me. He sent his son to die for me when I was still a sinner, and so how am I supposed to do? I should love my wife and my harvest family, regardless of their sins and weaknesses. Be kind and tender-hearted towards one another, forgiving each other just as Lord in Christ, God in Christ has forgiven you, Ephesians 4:32. I should be living that out with Chris. I should be living that out with you because God did that for me. I believe that with all my heart that he loves me unconditionally. So what am I going to do about it? In faith, I'm going to love Chris that same way. And not hold things against her. And the same thing for you guys. We got to do this together. Third thing I said was, God's plans are perfect and good. I'm going to trust him with my MS. I'm just going to trust him with my MS. I don't like it. Wish I didn't have to deal with it. But I'm going to trust him. I know it's what's best for me. And I'm going to believe that, and I'm going to tell people that. That's the I will part. I believe his plans are perfect and good for me. So what am I going to do? I'm walking forward with a great attitude about the struggle that I have. Because I truly 100, you guys, most of you know me pretty well. You know how I feel about it. I'm like, okay, let's get after this together. That's how I feel. I wouldn't choose it, but I'm going to have joy in the midst of it because I believe that. So you do that this week. Journal a few things of what you believe about God and then figure out what is that going to make you do. And both are commendable and both are rewarded by God if it's done in faith. Does that make sense? Shake your head if you're understanding what I said. All right, so you got some stuff to do when you're in family camp. All right? At this time, I want to invite Marcia and Cass up. Where are Marcia and Cass? Come on up. We want to commend them. We're going to do a little practical application right now. And the work that these two put in for High Five, I'm telling you, the fruitfulness from High Five is phenomenal. We will never... We will never know the lengths of fruitfulness until we all get to heaven of what High Five does. We get to see a bunch. I got great texts this week from multiple people about kids coming, and we're so glad if you're here today. If you had kids at High Five and you haven't come to our church, you don't have a church, come be a part of our thing. God's great, and we love God, and we'll love you like we love each other. So you're definitely welcome to join our family. But I just wanted to give an example, a living example. The reason that Marcia and Cass give of their time, energy, gifts like they do is not because it's fun, although it is. They do it because of their faith. They're commended. I believe that God is going to commend them and reward them by what they did at High Five, not because they did stories with the children, because it was their faith that allowed them to do it, and that's going to be their reward. The fruitfulness is his job. It's his responsibility. It's his glory, not Cass's and Marcia's. Their glory is they did it in faith. That's what God commends. That's what God rewards, not if 15 kids came. Are they going to get more commended next year when 35 kids come to Christ versus 15 this year? Oh, more and more for that. No, that has nothing to do with it. Whether zero kids came to Christ or whether 15 kids came to Christ, it doesn't matter. If they did it in faith, it was commendable and rewarded by God. All right? I just want to say thank you publicly to you. Thank you, guys. And go. So the first point of our message is persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. The second is persevering faith receives God's approval. And here's the last point. Persevering faith knows God's power. Persevering faith knows God's power. Verse 3. By faith, again, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. So the writer now gives a really powerful example of believing without seeing. He's kind of going back to support point one. A really powerful example of believing without seeing. The creation of the universe. He's like, let's go right to the pinnacle of faith in the unseen. You and I didn't see Jesus walk the earth. We weren't there for the resurrection, but people were. Lots of people were, and they gave testimony. That's one of the reasons you can have 100% confidence. You're not believing in some fairy tale. It's true. Jesus walked the earth. He didn't sin. He healed people. He calmed the seas. Witnesses, 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 witnesses. You didn't see it, so you believe in it, which is commendable, right? But a lot of people did. But no one was there for this. By faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God. Maybe God created everything with no human witnesses, So we would be forced to rely on him and his word, and that we would need faith to believe. If there were human witnesses, we would not need to trust God as much, because we could trust the reality of the witnesses. And then God would be attested to us by someone else. But no one was there. And so this is the pinnacle of faith, believing that God spoke the universe into existence. The word understand, I love this word. The Greek word is noumen, which means rational thought that seeks principles of an outward thing. Rational thoughts. You don't check your mind at the door as a Christian. You can believe that God spoke the world into existence, for sure. When this writer was writing this to the Jews, there was Greek thought that was pervasive and growing, that there was formless matter that somehow came together to form the universe and the earth. Not unlike what many people think today, that there was some type of thing in space with actual substance that somehow, some way, came together to form the universe and the earth. I don't know about you, but that seems very illogical. I don't know about you, but that seems like actual lunacy. To think that somehow what we experience somehow was formed from some floating thing that somehow got charged or exploded into something so complex, so beautiful, so orderly. So I got my laptop here, and right now I want to just smash the thing because it's not working super great. So I might do it. That would be kind of cool, wouldn't it? But I want you to imagine for a minute that I started taking this apart piece by piece. Every minute little piece of this computer, every tiny chip into each of its individual pieces, every single thing, taking it all apart and put all the pieces from this laptop, every single thing individually, maybe 1,500 little tiny little pieces, and I put it in this box. My laptop is now in this box. All right? Now let's leave it in the parking lot and see how long it's going to take for the laptop to come together. You laugh. That's way better chance than somehow things floating, material substance, somehow coming together with some explosion. You know what happens when things explode? They break into what? Smaller pieces. But let's have a closed system now. We got all the right parts together. It's all there. It's not like they're floating everywhere and we got to just hope that over billions of years all the right things come together. We already got the right things. Come on. Come on, lightning. Hit it. Bam. 400,000 years from now, the lightning bolt might by chance hit it. And when the lightning bolt hits it, that charge is going to bring all those parts together and I'm going to be able to type on it. You laugh. But I'm telling you, we understand that God spoke it. It's the only logical thing. Talk about order in just one area of our current earth, the sky. Look at this picture. Look at the sunbeams. The sunbeams are straight. Straight. They obviously come out from the sun, but they are straight as straight can be. How can something be straight? How can something be straight? How can anything really be straight? I have no explanation other than God's created it that way. Nothing in science would make you believe that you could have something straight. What the heck? It's straight. Look at this. The rainbow. The rainbow. The rainbow, you can't see it, but every rainbow is a perfect, and I mean perfect, circle. The rest of the rainbow you can't see always because it's on the ground, but every single rainbow is a perfect circle. And every single rainbow is exactly 42 degrees in arc every single time. And when you see a secondary rainbow, every single secondary rainbow is 51 degrees. And in the rainbow, when it's 42 degrees, it starts with red on the top and goes down to violet every single time. When you see a second rainbow, it's inverted. The red's on the bottom, the violet, every single time. It's a perfect circle. It's a perfect circle. The human eye. Human eye, if one tiny little thing wasn't correct, you couldn't see. So how is evolution even possible? Though all those creatures couldn't see forever, because if they were evolving, they wouldn't be able to see. If they can't see, good luck living. You have to have every single component of the eye. A scientist will tell you, you can't have one little thing different or you can't see. The galactic movement of our solar system, everything in place, everything moving perfectly, everything staying the same distance, over and over and over and over. 4 feet closer to the sun, the earth burns up. 4 feet away from the sun, it freezes. It's perfect. It's held there. The power of the sun. I could go on and on and on with the power of God, and he, say it, spoke. I would love that power. Chocolate milkshake from Arby's. By the way, the best chocolate shakes are Arby's. So some of your application, go to Arby's and try one of their chocolate shakes. It blows away Chick-fil-A. It's the best. I would love that power, but only God has that power. Last thing, if I have faith, put this up on the screen, Rob. If I have faith that he spoke the universe into existence, I can persevere in faith through any trial or circumstance. Because nothing, you can read it, it's probably up there. Because nothing is impossible for God, who not only made it all, but upholds it all at this very moment by the word of his power. He didn't just make the world and wind it up like a grandfather clock and say, go do it. He's upholding it by the word of his power every single moment. As we close, I want you to turn to Hebrews chapter 1. Everybody flip over. Hebrews chapter 1. We're talking about Jesus here. Look at verse 3. Hebrews 1, verse 3. Jesus, he is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. We didn't get to see it, but those who did got to see God in the flesh. He was the exact imprint of the Holy Father, the perfect one, the creator, and Jesus was the exact imprint. And if we'd have lived 2,000 years, we would have been able to see it, but we didn't get to see it. But those of you that believe, it's commendable because of your faith. But look what it says. And he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making not just enough of him to be the creator, but look what he did. And after making purification for sins, yours and mine, on the cross, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. That's the God that we are convicted is real, though we can't see him. And he lives to make intercession. And he's reigning. And he's watching. And he knows your every thought. He knows your every deed. He knows your every care. And believe me, he still speaks. He still speaks. Let's pray. Father, forgive us for our lack of persevering faith. Father, forgive us for our fears. Forgive us for our doubts. Oh, we cry to you like the disciples did long ago. We say, increase our faith, God. Would you use this series this summer to increase our faith, spur us on, fuel us, fan our faith into flame. Help us hold fast to the reality that though we did not see you, you were led to a hill outside the gates of Jerusalem, where you were nailed to a cross, where you made purification for sin. And after that, you sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, and that's where you sit today, watching and moving and aiding and rescuing and delivering. We sit here today ready and willing to increase our faith. Do it today, God. Do it in us, God. We put our faith in you and you alone, the only one who can save. We pray all this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.